the use of picture in factor models to evaluate community patterns in microarray data. So the kind of data we will be dealing with is microarray data. I'm not going very deep into how this data is built. But basically, it represents gene expression. So here we have, in the rows, we have probes, which are small pieces of genetic segments. And in the columns, we have different samples from different individuals. So we're interested in detecting this kind of pattern we have here on the left side image. We can see that the pattern appears in the sample, so we have coherent patterns in the samples, inside each sample. And this is important because it's an important source of information to evaluate gene activity. So we're interested in detecting this kind of pattern. Here we can see an example of matrix that is basically random. We don't have patterns here. So there are two popular metrics in the literature that deals with this kind of problem. One of them is the MAS 5.0, which is a method that uses the information from the mismatch and perfect match probes to build this score, an R score. It's a very simple method because it deals with one sample at a time. It doesn't look at all samples at the same time. So this score here is built for each sample, and then it's evaluated through a Wilcoxon and Sine drawing test. And depending on the p-value, it's classified as absent, marginal, or present. So we have one classification for each sample, and then the classification of the probe set is the most frequent classification from all the samples. The other method is the PAFP. It was proposed by Warren and others 2007, and it uses information from the negative strength matching process to build an empirical cumulative distribution. Actually, they use 1 minus the empirical cumulative distribution, the survival curve. And based on some cutoff points, they classify each sample as absent, marginal, or present. And as happened in the MAS 5.0, the most frequent classification between the samples is the classification of the probe set. So the sparse latent factor model, it takes a very simple form, another factor model form, where X is the data matrix. So here we'll be dealing with just one factor. It can easily be extended to more factors, but we're dealing with the one factor case. So alpha and lambda are vectors instead of matrices. So alpha is the vector of loadings, it's the strength of the patterns. Lambda is the vector of factor score, it describes the patterns. And epsilon is the noise term, which is normally distributed with zero mean. And here we have the sigma squared I. So we have one different sigma for each probe. We expect the probes to have the same variance. One sigma, one different variance for each probe, but the same variance for each sample. So as you can see here, if we let alpha and lambda vary freely, we may have some identification problems. So to deal with this, we set normal 0,1 as the normal prior distribution for the lambda. For the sigma squared I, we use the conjugate inverse gamma. And here is where the mixture appears. We use a spike and slab mixture to evaluate the significance of each factor, of each alpha I here. So if you're sampling from this part of the mixture, it's a degenerate distribution in zero, then we understand that the strength of this I factor is zero. if you're sampling from the non-zero part of the distribution, here we have a normal distribution with a very large variance to allow a broad range of values, then we understand that this effect is different from zero. So we have this Zi variable that indicates from which part of the mixture you're sampling. And this Qi is the prior probability of sampling from the non-zero part of the mixture. We will not we don't have covariance here to try to better understand this value, so we will give the same probabilities for all values between 0 and 1. So here we're most interested in the classification of the matrix, the data matrix, as pattern or no pattern. So the parameter we're most interested in is this Qi star, which is the posterior probability of sampling from the non-zero part of the mixture. So this is the parameter that will tell us about the presence or absence of a pattern. So we had to normalize it, so that it's a value between 0 and 1. And okay, so how the classification is done? We build an HPD interval for this value. We'll have one Qi star for each probe, for each alpha I. And then we'll look to the interval. So if the superior limit of the interval is smaller than 0.5, or in other words, all the intervals below 0.5, then you say that the pattern is absent here for this specific probe. If the interval contains 0.5, then you say that the classification is marginal, so you're not sure if it's present or absent. And if the inferior limit of the interval is greater than 0.5, or all the intervals above 0.5, you say that a pattern is present in that probe. So we have one classification for each alpha I, and the classification of the probe set will be the most frequent classification among all the alpha I classifications. So the first experiment we did was just a sanity check to verify if the algorithm was correctly implemented. I'm using Gibbs sampling. So we generated random parameters and generated the data from these parameters, and then we tried to estimate those parameters back. And everything ran okay. The model was good implemented. The changes are conversion. Here, those plots present the real values, the estimated values, and the HPD intervals for alpha, lambda, and sigma parameters. And as you can see, most of the real values falls inside the HPD interval. So we conclude that the model was well implemented. So the second experiment, we focus on the classification of the matrices instead of the parameters. So we generated simulated data based on real case. We wanted the matrix to look like the real matrix we were analyzing. But we set some matrices to have no effect. So we generated 500 matrices. The first 200, we set them to have no effect, and we left the other 300 to have effect. And that's what we want to the model to classify, to estimate. So here in the x-axis we have the index of the matrix, we have 500 matrices. And in the y-axis we have the proportion of probe sets of each matrix that was classified as present. So the first 200 matrices, 0%, none of the probe set was classified as present. So we classified all those matrices as absent. And for the other 300 matrices, we had at least 0.5 or 0.6 of the matrices of the probes classified as present. So we classified all those remaining 300 matrices as present. So we had no misclassification here, all the 500 matrices was correctly classified. 5. Here we have now C curve for the sparse latent vector model for the other two methods we were studying. So the gray curve represents the MAS 5.0 presence absence. Here we have many lines because we built one ROC curve for each sample. We don't have this in this sparse latent vector model because we use all the samples in one analysis at the same time. So we can see that the PAMP gets a better performance than the MAS 5.0. And this time here represents the sparse latent vector model. We were able to get 100% of true positive with 0% of false positive. So here's the first experiment with real data. It's a spiking experiment. There are 42 probe sets that were known to be absent in the original data set, to the arrays that we were analyzing. And they were inserted, they were spiked into them. So we expect the model to classify all the 42 probe sets as present because we forced them to be there. They used 42 different hybridization solutions with concentrations ranging from 0 parts per million to 500 parts per million. And as the image showed here, BMS stands for Bayesian vector model, it's the same of the sparse latent vector model. The Bayesian model was the only one to classify correctly or as present the 42 probe sets. As you can see, the PMP and the MAS 5.0 presence absence missed some, and the Bayesian vector model classified as expected all of the 42 probe sets as present. So the fourth experiment is a full real data analysis. We analyzed 22,283 probe sets from a breast cancer data set. And here we don't have the real classification, so we just have comparisons to the other two methods. The MAS 5.0 classified 46.9% as present, the PAMP classified 32, and the sparse latent vector model just classified 1.9% as present. So it was, this data set was much stricter than the other two to classify a presence. Here we made thinking that he was not very strict to classify as present because he classified all the 42 as present. So here we can see that it's not like that. But here in this data set he was more strict than the other two methods. And here we have a real data analysis with CMA plots. Copy number alteration is a very important field of study in genetics field. So here the data is slightly different because we don't have more probes in the rows, but each matrix that we were analyzing before is summarized in a row. So we have each row here represents one probe set and not a probe anymore. So here we have four data sets from breast cancers. And we have a box plot at the left side of each plot with the QI star value. So as I expect here, the rows with high values of QI star presents a very strong pattern, as you can see here. And the rows with lower values of QI star presents mostly random data. So you can see patterns over here. So Lucas and other 2010 presented a list of genes that presented patterns due to copy number alteration for breast cancer. And we were able to to identify these patterns that we used the same gene list, studied it, analyzed it using our model, and we were able to identify the same patterns here. And then we wanted to run this analysis for other types of cancer cells. We analyzed these other two data sets from ovarian, brain, and lung cancers. The same genes that was presented in the Lucas study. And we were able to find patterns here as well. We have high values of QI star here as well, but here the sample was much smaller. Here we had almost 100 samples, and here we just have 59 samples. So the pattern, it's hard to capture the pattern here, but there is some smaller effect here. We can see some blue cells here and some red cells here. So we were able to identify patterns in other types of cancer cells as well. So we are using a Bayesian factor model to evaluate coherent patterns that indicate gene activity. The modern algorithm implementation ROK is estimates for other parameters and the change of conversion. We have compared the sparse latent factor model with other methods, and we noticed that this sparse latent factor model has superior performance in identifying those coherent patterns. In the real data analysis, we noticed that this sparse latent factor model is stricter in indicating gene activity. An important point here is that this, while those two methods are very simple because they look at each sample at a time, this sparse latent factor model jointly analyzes the pattern of all samples. And we were able to identify coherent patterns with the CMA in other types of cancer cells, as ovarian, brain, and lung. So, future works. We discovered that implementation of deep sampling using algorithms is very slow. For the real data analysis, it took over a week to run all the chains. While those other two methods are very fast, this one using these R loops are very slow. So we found out that using R in C++ can drastically, in the RCPP package, can drastically reduce the time of calculations. And now we're working on this, using RCPP and R in C++ to implement this algorithm much faster than we can run that now. So some reference here. My ring presented this paper to appear, but presented a very similar paper, a very similar model. This paper from Lucas presents the gene list from breast cancer that present patterns in the CLA data. This paper first presented the PAMP methods. And those other two references uses the mixture. This package like mixture represent here in the context of variable selection. That's it. Thank you very much.